Everybody to this next session of PHO virtual training. At the foremost, I wish to thank the PHO chapter, Dr. Manglani, Sunil, Anita, for giving us, giving me and our team an opportunity to present this session. Today here we have with us our experts, Dr. Nitin Shah, who doesn't need introduction either to me or to this entire group. But sir is a consultant at Vadiya Children's Hospital and at Hinduja Hospital. He has been the past president of IIP as well as the past president of the PHO chapter. I also have with me Dr. Sandeep Bartake, who is my colleague at Bharti Hospital. He is a consultant at Bharti as well as Aditya Birla Hospital and at Surya Hospitals. And we have a fun time working together. With me to present our cases is our young brigade, Dr. Ashna Valecha and Dr. Parag Mahankar. So with this, I think I would start my presentation. Can I share my screen?
We also have some very senior hemato-oncologists from the country who are supervising us. I see Dr. Reddy smiling there.
Hi Reddy, welcome everybody. It's nice to see all the known faces.
Go ahead. So I think I'm going to mute myself till you finish your...
Today our session is going to be on an approach to hyperchromic microcytic anemia. The scope of our session is going to be approach to the hyperchromic microcytic anemia, and then we will go on to take different clinical cases. And as the cases roll on, we will have relevant discussion on nutritional iron deficiency anemia, all aspects of that, treatment of the same, recognition of different causes of iron deficiency anemia other than nutritional, and the pseudo as well as a true iron refractory anemias, and other conditions presenting as hyperchromic microcytic anemias. Anemia. So starting with something very basic, anemia is defined as a reduction in the hemoglobin, hematocrit, or number of RBCs to standard deviations below the normal. This is the textbook definition. The routine thing is to see a hemoglobin less than the cutoff values for that age, and the pathophysiological definition is the reduction in the oxygen carrying capacity. Nowadays, all of us have access to excellent hemogram reports from automated cell counters. These amazing cell counters can, within minutes, they can count all the circulating blood cells, they can estimate RBC volume, the RDW, the hemoglobin, hematocrit, they can compute so many values like RDW, etc. And we have newer and newer counters rolled on every day. So coming on to that, even in this era, we have to start with a very good history, which can give us good pointers towards the presence of anemia, the intensity of that, and looking at clues, whether there are any clues in the history leading to anemia, for example, bleeding or evidence of any hemolytic cases. Never to forget family history, consanguinity, race, ethnicity. We will see the importance of all these points as we go on with our presentation. And then looking at signs of chronic illnesses. And having taken a good history, we have to do a good examination, look at gross things as like presence of cardiac failure or presence of hepatosplenomegaly, or look at very minor things like glossitis, stomatitis, knuckle pigmentations, or polyneuropathy, paronychia. And look at any dysmorphic phases. So after the history examination is done, the next is a screening test. Looking at a hemogram is just like, for us hematology, looking at that is like, it's like an examination. So this hemogram or a complete blood cell count can give us all these values. You look at it as giving information on three cell lines: the RBC cell line, the WBC cell line, and the platelets. On the RBC cell line, you look at the hemoglobin, hematocrit, and the blood indices, the MCV, MCH, MCHC, RDW. Look at the retic count. Don't forget to look at the total WBC counts and the differential, the platelet counts, and in relation to the anemia. all said and done, a good peripheral smear done by an experienced pathology, the experienced eye, goes a very long way to help us. Then, when you're evaluating a CBC report, there are some points. You should be sure that your machine on what it is done is sanitized. Practically, it means to having a good rapport with the laboratory that you're routinely sending, having a rapport with the pathologist. See to it that your platelet counts and WBC differential are confirmed by the human eye. Then going on to anemia, the MCV is a key parameter in the classification of anemia. Look, keeping that in mind, look at the RDW. RDW is red cell distribution width, and it is the objective confirmation of the anisocytosis, which is seen by the human eye. Then look at the RBC count and look at, as I said, relation of WBC and platelet counts, followed by a PS. So these are the points on a CBC report. Then this is, I've just put this to see that how complicated the CBC report can look on the most modern of analyzers. Apart from giving all the values which I've mentioned, the newest parameters, the Siemens 7-part automated counters can give information on all your retics, the retic percentage, absolute value, the reticulocyte hemoglobin content, the immature granulocytes, and so many. So then coming on to, this is a beautiful peripheral blood smear, which is showing all the three cell lines. This is the normal mature lymphocyte, a normal mature neutrophil, the platelets, and look at the RBCs. They have their 1/3 classical central pallor. They are almost same in size and shape. So when you have a child who comes in with anemia, you must answer three questions. First, is the child anemic? Next, what is the cause of anemia? And then finally, what is the type of anemia? Why do I ask, is the child anemic? Because look at this. Our children have different cutoff values and different normal values at all different ages. For example, a neonate may have a hemoglobin between 14 and 18.5, and 12, at 12 you would call a neonate anemic. Whereas it reaches a nadir at about 6 months to 2 years. So we should always have this in mind.
Thank you, Rick.
Then finally, having done that, look at the etiopathogenesis of anemia. So this is a very good chart which can broadly classify all your anemia. This is good for understanding, but unfortunately our little children, our little patients don't read textbooks and come. So this is not going to be of any help in your day-to-day practice. What will help us is the MCV. So first you see whether this is anemia, and then you look at the MCV. So with the help of MCV, you can divide the anemias into microcytic, that is when your MCV is less than 70, or macrocytic when it is more than 96, and rest of all them are the normocytic. A very good way to calculate, know the lower levels would be to add age in years to 70 for the lower limit of MCV, add 0.6 per year to 84 to find the upper level. But it is okay if you just remember that any MCV below 70 or above 95 is abnormal. Just few working points. If you have low MCV and a high RDW, that means this may be most probably an iron deficiency anemia or a thal major. If MCV is low again and the RDW is normal, most probably it is a thalassemia minor. And the other way around, if you have high MCV and a high RDW is again deficiency, but this time it is B12 folate. And if you have a normal RDW, it is a blastocomia. So this is a working kind of formula. So let's now look at all these cases and let's see how all the things that we've seen above come to test. And we'll see all these cases and let's see how all these things apply to help us in the diagnosis. Ashna, can you start with the first case?
We had a 10-month-old male child who was well-nourished but pale, came for routine vaccination visit. On examination, liver was 2 centimeters palpable, soft in consistency, spleen was not palpable, rest was normal. His CBC was, hemoglobin was moderately anemic, 6.4 gram%, RBC count was low, 3.34, MCV was microcytosis 62, RDW was raised 18.7%, TLC and platelets were within normal limits, and retic count was 3%.
So Sandeep, can you just help us to interpret this case, interpret the indices, think of what would be your diagnosis? or if you require any more history or any more tests.
So first, let me interpret the analysis. So this is a 10-month-old child with severe anemia, HbA of 6.4 gram. So the first thing, as you said just now, that we should look at MCV, because we classify anemia as microcytic, normocytic, or macrocytic. So here the MCV is 64, so definitely microcytic. The next thing we should look at is MCH. So it is 50, which is low, so hypochromic. And now the next thing we should look at is RBC count. So RBC count is low. So anything below 4.5 million is low. And RBW is 18.7, which is increased. So this fits into typical picture of iron deficiency anemia.
You want to ask any further questions?
Yeah, so before that, let me... as a hematologist, we should always correlate these indices with histograms and peripheral smear. So if you go to peripheral smear,
Just a word before that, you have a platelet count which is very high in this child. It's almost 5.8 lakhs. That again will tell you that's more likely to be iron deficiency because they come with high platelet counts.
Yes.
And we have seen sometimes counts up to as much 7 lakhs, 8 lakhs in some children.
Absolutely.
I want to ask Ashna, how do you interpret this retic count of 3%?
Retic count is raised in this, it is 3%.
So you have to correct it for the hematocrit, or you correct only in aplastic anemias.
Corrected retic count will be low.
Yeah. So the, if the retic was really high in this child, what would you think of, Ashna? Can you hear?
ITP.
Is high in such a child, then there are two possibilities. Either someone has given iron without your knowledge, if his iron deficient is showing some response, or he's bleeding. Whenever an iron deficient child bleeds, like in GI because of worms, then the retic will jump for some time. Go ahead, Sandeep.
Yeah, so retic count, as you rightly suggested, that we have to correct it for the PCV.
So looking at this smear, what would you think, Sandeep, is the
So again, first you look at the RBC size. So what is the reference level? The reference is nucleus of a mature lymphocyte. So if the RBCs are smaller than that, then they are microcytic. So as in this case, most of the RBCs are small, so microcytic. So next you look at the central pallor. If it is more than 1/3 of the diameter of RBCs, it is hypochromic. So again, most of the cells are hypochromic. And if you see the variation in the size of the RBCs, there is a lot of variation suggesting anisocytosis, which is reflected in high RBW. Okay. So and again, if you look carefully, there is slight increase in the platelet count. So all the things that were informed in the Coulter, we can confirm on a peripheral smear.
So okay. Ashna, how do you know the platelet count is normal or high on a peripheral smear under microscope? I'm going to take her exam. I hope people don't mind. I think this should be interactive more than only didactic from us. Yeah, Ashna.
See the platelet count on peripheral smear.
How? How do you know it's roughly how much?
Small size.
What size? Numbers. How many numbers in high power field?
How many numbers in the high power field?
High power field is normal.
More than
roughly one platelet per high power field corresponds to 1,000 platelet counts. So you have 10 to 15 per high power field, it tells you count is 1 to 1.5 lakhs. Here you can count almost 10,000, not 1,000.
Yeah. 10,000.
So you can see so many of them. This tells you that the platelet is very high. Okay, go ahead, Sandeep.
Both the indices and peripheral smear suggest iron deficiency anemia.
So, what would you like further in the history, Sandeep, or you want further tests?
So, considering the age, the most common cause of IIDA is nutritional. So, I would rather ask a detailed diet history or nutritional history rather than doing any test.
Okay. So, Ashna, can you tell us the dietary history?
Dietary history was few breastfeeds and fresh cow's milk, which was approximately 500 to 750 ml with bottle. History of infrequent weaning of foods was present. Mother gives history that she was giving 5 drops once a day, which was 0.3 mg per kg per day of a ferrous iron preparation, but compliance was poor due to taste. On inquiry, the mother had finished just one bottle of the medicine.
In the last 3 months, right? Yeah, so though she said that she was taking oral iron, so we should not be fooled by it. And we should ask the detailed history that how she was giving how many bottles. Okay, now Sandeep, what do you have to say?
In the patient is taking excessive cow's milk, so and which is poor in iron, so it is bioavailability of iron is very poor. So cow's milk can cause slow bleeding, upper blood loss. So it is all consistent iron deficiency anemia. In a typical case, I would not do any test to confirm iron deficiency and rather treat it.
Sir, would, at this point, I would like to ask you, sir, your comment on the case as well as the prevalence of nutritional iron deficiency anemia in infants, adolescents. How would you treat? What would be your formulations, etc., etc.?
Are you asking me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so number one, on peripheral smear, if you also see ovalocytosis, that's very typical of nutritional iron deficiency. So that confirms. When you see iron deficiency, don't think that it can be mixed anemia. So look at the polymorph very carefully. Whether you see hypersegmented poly, you know it's dimorphic. And sometimes your MCV may be normal on a counter or near normal, and yet you may have gross micro and macro, which cancel out each other on a counter. But it tells you that there is so much of iron deficiency.
So peripheral smear is of utmost importance.
That's right. So that's number one. Number two. Now this is a, I mean, this is a sad story. You know, this is a story in 8 or 9 out of 10 children in 1970s. And nothing much has improved in 1990s to 2000 to 2020.
Absolutely.
Almost 50% of the child population and girls and women of women of childbearing age are anemic. I mean, you don't know whether they're iron deficient, but they're anemic. And most of the common cause of anemia is iron deficiency. And in spite of having a National Anemia Prophylaxis Program from 1970 to now National Anemia Control Program, now to named as National Initiate Iron Plus Initiative, we are juggling with the names, but we are really not coming to reducing the iron deficiency prevalence. And my worry is not the anemia. If you give iron, anemia will get corrected. But iron is not only anemia, it's beyond anemia. So it has cognitive dysfunction, neurological symptom, it can have other muscular symptom, etc. Especially cognitive dysfunctions may not improve. And there have been beautiful studies done in Canada and other countries where they followed up children who are iron deficient as infants till adolescence, comparing children who are normal along with them and following them till adolescence. They found that the cognitive dysfunction, dependence on the school, poor peer-to-peer interactions, poor marking, needing tuition classes, etc., remains till adolescence. So, I mean,
it's irreversible.
Irreversible. Sometimes the parents are very reluctant to stop the bottle. And my answer, my only one statement to them is that how would you like your child has potential to become doctor, but because you give him, don't give him iron and you give him bottle, he may actually become a nurse or a ward boy. Is that okay for you? Then it's okay for me. And I think
so what is this about cow's milk and the iron deficiencies? I want you to
any milk which is excess is not good. You should not introduce animal milk in the first year according to Western standard, because they have a very high incidence of cow's milk protein allergy, and that leads to microbleeding, which leads to further iron deficiency. In our country, we don't see it so much. But I think the problem in our country is that because the child is on bottle and also probably continuing breastfeeding, he's predominantly on milk diet, so he's depleted of the weaning food. So typically, a child grows well for the first 6 months because he's on breast milk. After the faltering starts, and by 1 year, the child has not put on much weight. Now he looks a little thin and he's anemic. And remember, anemia is not only iron, it is also protein, zinc, copper, so many other micronutrients, which will be missing if it's not on a balanced diet. So the problem is not only with milk alone, but also that the milk depletes the child's chance of getting a good diet, which is balanced, giving other micronutrients. So many times you will see that you give iron, the child becomes okay, and you stop, and then again the child goes back. Why? It's because he's not taking enough protein or he's not taking other micronutrients.
So in your practice, how would you start treating this child?
So 3 mg/kg is what I start, because I feel that if there is iron deficiency, even little iron you give is almost completely absorbed. So there are less side effect with 3 mg compared to 6 mg, but the dose is 3 to 6 mg. You just muster one salt that you like, whether it's ferrous sulfate, ferrous fumarate, ferrous magnesium sulfate, or the newer iron salts. You know only one of them nicely, one which is cheaper, good in taste, and prescribe that, because you cannot memorize. There are so many, some containing as low as 20 and 30 milligram in 15 ml, to some used to passing contain 300 milligram per 5 ml, to 100 milligram per 5 ml, and so on and so forth. So you should be very careful about what you write. I prefer between the meals, if or not an empty stomach, okay, if the child cannot tolerate, then even with the milk, even with the food is okay, and maybe at bedtime, because the GI symptom may become less during sleep time. If the child can tolerate once a day, that's fine. Otherwise, you can break it into twice a day. So any jugglery is okay. Even if you give alternate day, it will work.
But especially for constipation. For children who are having side effects of constipation, if you give it alternate day, I think it works.
Right. But therapeutically, it's better to give the iron daily possible as compared to alternate day or twice a week. Or twice a week or once a week is more prophylaxis rather than therapeutic. There are side effects of every drug, including iron. So there will be some nausea, vomiting. But the children get used to it. So you need to caution the parent that you don't stop it because this happens. You consult us. You can maybe reduce the dose, maybe make it twice a day, twice a week, and then gradually increase it so that ultimately the child is able to tolerate a dose of at least 3 mg/kg.
Sir, how do you judge the erythropoietic response to iron, pathophysiologically and clinically, both ways?
So immediately as you start the iron, the child starts feeling well. I mean, the mother can tell that the child is now more concentrating, is less irritable, and he wants to eat. That's number one. Number two, you can actually do a retic count on day 5 or day 7. There'll be good retic response. If you don't do, that's perfectly fine. You check your hemoglobin at 1 month. There should be rise of at least 1 to 1.5 grams. Hemoglobin may not rise very fast in the first 1 month. But by third month, you have seen that the hemoglobin is almost near normal. And then you continue iron for another 3 months for the replenishment of the stores. So that's a complete treatment. This is what you call iron challenge test. Like Dr. Sandeep very rightly said that he will not do ferritin or serum iron, TIBC. It's a waste of money. You know, it's a classical case. Just give them iron and follow up. If they don't improve, then he has to investigate them. But if they improve, then just complete the therapy.
In your routine practice, what do you think are the causes of inadequate response to irons?
So
in day-to-day, in children with nutritional deficiencies.
Yeah, so one is a wrong diagnosis, not iron deficiency, something else like thalassemia minor. Number two is compliance. So the child is not taking or the mother is not giving properly. So you have to have pill counts if you are giving tablets and bottle counts if you are giving syrups and drops. So mother brings back the pack and you see how much he should have consumed vis-a-vis how much he's actually consumed. Okay. Then true intolerance, child vomits out, child doesn't take. So parents also don't give it properly. These are the three or four. Then of course, if you are iron deficient, which is not primary nutrition, if it's secondary, like poor absorption, or if there's bleeding from somewhere like GI in or in the lung somewhere, which is more than what the child can absorb, then again, you will not have good response. And lastly, there are some rare iron deficiency disorders where oral iron may not work, malabsorption, celiac, so many, IRD, I mean, there are some mutation in the metabolic pathways. All of them may not respond to oral iron. But that is very rare. 99 out of 100 is going to be nutritional, will respond very beautifully to iron.
Sir, I've heard about what are the things which will hamper iron absorption.
So too much of phytates, tea, tannates, etc. So you see, Britishers had this, I mean, I always find that Indians are much smarter than Britishers. Though they ruled for 100 years, that's a different thing. But British have tea after their diet, and tea actually hampers the absorption of iron. Where Indians always like to eat a fruit like orange after the diet. It gives vitamin C, which increases the absorption of iron. So we are always smarter, even without the knowledge of science, that actually it works well. So the point I'm making is taking too much of tea, etc., is not good. Like in thalassemia, you tell them to take tea, right, after meals to prevent absorption. Here is the other. You tell them to eat a fruit, which is citrus.
Ashna, can you tell us what happened to this child of ours?
So we started with the oral iron, which was 4 mg/kg per day of elemental ferrous salt. So response was seen on day 5. The retic count was increased to 6%. CBC was done at 6 weeks, which showed hemoglobin of 10.5 gram per deciliter. Other RBC indices were normal. So oral iron was continued for 3 months for repletion of the stores.
Okay, so this child was of a classical infant with a nutritional iron deficiency anemia who had an excellent result. So we go on to our next case, number two. Parag, can you tell us the history? Parag?
Before you go to the case two, I think for the students, this is for PG teaching, right?
Right, sir.
So I think the student must read the 2019 paper from Dr. Umesh Kapil from All India National Medical Sciences, his group. They have extensively, looked at the anemia in children and in community in India, right from 1970 when the National Anemia Prophylaxis Program was made, then to convert it to control program, to the Iron Plus program, etc. How it has failed, what is the prevalence, NFHS-4 data, NFHS-5 data, recently out yesterday. All these they must read, because I think they may get a question on NIPI, that is National Iron Plus Initiative. So it's there. I mean, if anyone wants it, just email me and I'll send you the paper.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much for that.
This is a 4-year-old boy. He's from the Sindhi community. He brought to the pediatrician with a non-specific complaints of poor appetite, not gaining weight and height. He had received multiple courses of oral vitamins, minerals, ions, calciums in the past. He is normal, playful and healthy child. On examination, child was averagely nourished but had a mild pallor. Rest of the examination is normal. There is no evidence of any hepatomegaly or splenomegaly. The CBC done showed there is a moderate anemia with hemoglobin of 9.6. RBC count is 6.03 millions per cubic unit. There is a microcytosis with MCV of 54.2 and the RDW was normal, 14%, with a retic count of 1%.
So why do you call it moderate anemia? With 9.6 at 4 years is...
Mild anemia, 9.6 right. Years.
Okay. Sandeep, can you comment on this case?
Again, quickly. So this is a boy from Sindhi community, not symptomatic. Mild anemia, increased RBC count, severe microcytosis, hypochromia, and RDW being normal. And retic count is normal.
So on the peripheral sphere,
this was fixed with thalassemia minor. Now if you look at the sphere, of course there is no lymphocyte to compare with, but this, I suppose these are microcytosis and hypochromia is evident. Now you can also notice in the center there are little larger cells with bluish inclusion bodies. So these are called basophilic stippling. So this is again classically seen in beta thalassemia minor.
So other characteristics
cell which cannot see.
Sorry to interrupt, sir, but one of you will have to quit mute yourself. Either you or Ashna, ma'am, because you're in the same room, so there will be a lot of echo. So I request whoever is speaking, the other person should kindly mute themselves.
Okay, Sandeep. So how would you think?
Can you hear me? Yes. Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Okay. So beta thalassemia minor is closest differential diagnosis for iron deficiency. So as we have learned, RBC count will be low in iron deficiency, high in thalassemia minor. Menzer index, which is MCV divided by RBC count, will be high in iron deficiency, more than 13, and less than 13 in thalassemia minor. RDW will be high in iron deficiency, normal in thalassemia minor. Obviously, the ferritin will be low in iron deficiency and normal, but sometimes even beta thalassemia minor can be associated with iron deficiency, and there your ferritin may be low. And HbA2 will be normal in iron deficiency or low in iron deficiency and high in beta thalassemia minor. Of course, iron deficiency anemia will respond to iron trial, and there will be not much response in beta thalassemia minor patients.
So in case Sandeep, a child with thalassemia minor has iron deficiency, so anything on CBC gives you a pointer that may be the case. We can't hear you.
I know, why is he muting himself?
So one of you will have to unmute yourself.
I am not muting.
Sandeep, continue. You are heard now. Yeah.
Okay. So, case the beta thalassemia 9 deficiency coexists, you'll have mixed picture. So, you may have RBC count, which will be a little higher, and your RDW will be higher in that case.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
So, and you'll have mixed picture.
Okay. So, Sandeep, this was a case. So, HbA1c was done, and HbA2 was found to be 5.1. So, this confirmed a case of thalassemia minor in this child.
I just want to add here that a disproportionately low MCV for the amount of hemoglobin should rouse a suspicion even without calculating the Menzer index. A higher BC count with a normal RDW should rouse a suspicion in the community. And remember, when you have of iron deficiency in a patient with thalassemia minor, you may defer doing your electrophoresis for 6 weeks. Exactly. You'll give them oral iron, and at the end of 6 weeks, you will do, because your A2 may be subdued to a low normal level. In a thalassemia minor, and you may miss on A2 also a coexisting condition. This comes probably in females who are carriers and also iron deficient.
Especially in pregnancy, that may be a confounder, because to give them that could have iron, lots of implications.
Yeah, so better to give them iron for 4 to 6 weeks and then do electrophoresis.
So that is practical approach, but sometimes when you in pregnancy, when you cannot wait for 6 weeks.
Time.
Yeah. So there, I think there are enough of studies which shows that even in iron deficiency, if you have beta thalassemia trait, your A2 is almost is always invariably high. So very rare chance that you'll have your A2 which will be low because of iron deficiency. So people have done studies about this. So in case of pregnancy where there's urgency, I think you may go ahead with HB electrophoresis. Mm-hmm. But in iron deficiency in a child, you can wait.
I would even say that if you have a doubt, always get a genetic test done. Because you
Yes.
Can we go on to the next case? Case third, Ashna, can you tell us a story?
You can't hear her. I think she has to unmute now, and Sandeep has to mute. Sandeep has to mute now. Huh? Right. Okay. Go ahead.
So we had an 18-month-old female child who came with complaints of loose stools in 6 months of age, 5 to 6 episodes per day, which was small with mucus and had fresh blood intermittently. She also had complaints of failure to thrive, severe anemia requiring multiple blood transfusions, and had received plenty of adequate course of iron. So her CBC was done. Hemoglobin was 5.8 gram per cent. RBC count was low, which was 3.3 million per cubic millimeter. MCV was microcytosis 60.4, MCH was 13, RDW was 16.8%, retic count was 1%, and WBC and platelets were within normal limits.
So, can you comment on this case and any pointers in the history which would lead to think differently?
Yeah, so if you can go to the slide number one again. Yeah, so this is the typical age for iron deficiency.
Exactly.
So between 9 months to 3 years is the commonest, up to 5 years you can see. But when there is history of fresh blood intermittently and patient needing transfusion, now iron deficient anemias can come walking to you with 2 grams, but they are rarely transfused unless they are unscrupulously going to some peripheral obolus place. If he is needing multiple transfusions, which means either it is not iron deficiency or it is beyond nutritional iron deficiency. And third thing is the fact that he is not responding to adequate courses of iron. So either he's not absorbing, or as I said before, he's bleeding more than what he can absorb. So there is a net negative balance which leads to iron deficiency perpetuating, needing transfusion because it is probably falling to very low level. So you need to rule out GI bleeding as a cause of iron deficiency rather than a true nutritional cause. So the next slide.
Sir, I'm transgressing a little. I want you also to comment on giving blood to treat nutritional deficiency. So you must make a point.
So a single transfusion in any time in life for nutrition anemia is a complete no-no. Because you can have a 2 gram hemoglobin in an iron deficiency who is so well compensated because it is so chronic. You give them oral iron and follow them up weekly or monthly thereafter, and most of them are okay. So giving transfusion can be hazardous to them. But if they're in failure, which is by having tachycardia, a positive hepatogenic reflux, and your JVP raised, in which case, yes, you are justified in transfusing. In such patient, hardly they will be okay with one transfusion. They will probably need 2 or 3. So that, and second, if you give transfusion to them, don't be over enthusiastic and give and correct hemoglobin within 24 to 48 hours from 2 gram to 12 gram. They may convulse because of thrombosis in the cerebral venous system. Okay.
So, you have already enumerated, sir, that there are the different clauses. So, apart GI is the commonest thing to bleed, but you must also look rarely at other places where you can lose blood, for example, pulmonary hemosiderosis,
yes,
or even chronic renal failures.
Yes.
In adolescent females, don't forget to ask the menstrual history.
Yes.
And of course, then there are chronic inflammatory diseases. In this case, Ashna,
serum ferritin was done, which was low 1 nanogram per ml. Stool for occult blood was positive. Renal function and liver function test were done, which was normal. Further, colonoscopy was done.
Colonoscopy in view of fresh blood in stool. So,
yeah,
of course, you have to rule out the GI, lower GI bleeds. And here was the
Even Meckel's can come with fresh blood. So, maybe a Meckel scan and then a colonoscopy, or either way. I mean, it doesn't matter.
Absolutely. It depends on the rate of blood loss. If you're losing a lot, you may end up with fresh blood.
The
so
other thing is, these are the patients where doing iron studies is justified. You want to prove that it is iron deficient and then to look out for the secondary causes. Here you had fresh blood in the stool. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes
yeah,
you may not have fresh blood, but you may still bleed 4 or 5 ml every day, which in a small child is 10 months, 11 months, may be enough to lead to a recurrent iron deficient anemia like picture. Because I remember a child exactly like that came to me. Never had history of bleeding. Stool for occult blood was positive. He needed transfusion. We did an upper and lower GI scopy. First upper GI scopy because he didn't have fresh blood. And it picked up duodenal polyps.
Mm-hmm.
And he was bleeding from there every day. But never had hematemesis. Never had fresh blood in the stools.
And that also we need to do at least 3 stool occult bloods before
minimum.
We say it's negative. That's
yes,
very important because GI is a commonest source. So
yeah,
here we had a rewarding thing. He had this polyposis. And Sandeep, would you like to comment? Sir has already mentioned about iron studies.
So just one question for your fellow. So when you see this polyposis as a cause and iron deficiency and bleeding, you need to unmute your mic so that you can answer. Yeah. Ashna's mic. Yeah.
Parag. Unmute.
So I asked that if there are this multiple polyposis in this child, what is the one thing that you will look into the face of the child to come to a genetic diagnosis? Okay, I'll give you a further clue. You look at the lips of the child or the oral mucosa of the child. And this child will have family history of GI cancers. Now, I think more than this, I can't tell you.
Pukes Jaggers.
Jaggers.
Right? Yes, sir.
Especially microhemangiomas on the inner side of the buccal mucosa or on the lips. All right. Sorry, Sandeep.
Can you highlight the different tests for now coming on from the routine test for iron deficiency? Can you tell us about the advanced test for iron deficiency?
Unmute.
So as sir said, in such cases, we will definitely would like to document there is iron deficiency. So especially if there is no functional test that we do for iron deficiency, serum iron, TIBC, which is indirect measure of transferrin saturation, which is a calculated value, which is serum iron divided by TIBC into 100, and serum ferritin. Okay, so serum iron, you should remember it. It has diurnal variation. It is affected by your iron content in your recent diet as well as supplements. So you should remember all this when you interpret the serum iron. Preferably, you should do serum iron in early in the morning fasting. Okay. So the serum ferritin probably the most specific test for iron deficiency when it is low in normal circumstances. Okay, there are different cutoffs which have been advocated by different expert groups, but what I remember or what is commonly followed is WHO definition. So if your serum ferritin is less than 12 in less than 5 year old children, then it is iron deficiency. And for children more than 5 years, the cutoff is 15. Okay, the drawback of this lower cutoff is that it has low sensitivity. That means you will miss out on many children who have iron deficiency. So some group advocate higher cutoff like 20 or even 30. So another drawback of serum ferritin is it is an acute phase reactant. So it will be increased in conditions of infection, inflammation, or malignancy. So these are the routine tests. But now in last decade, there are a couple of tests which have become more popular. That is, one of them is reticulocyte hemoglobin content. Now this is measured on a cell counter, specific cell counter, especially Siemens. You get, it is very easy to do and you get immediate value. So if it is less than 28, that indicates that you have recent iron deficiency. And it is one of the good markers to document early response to iron treatment. The problem is it is not available everywhere. That is one of the problems. The second recent marker is soluble transferrin receptor. Now this is this reflects the erythropoietic activity of the bone marrow. So if it is high in iron deficiency, but it can also be high in conditions where there is increased erythropoiesis, for example, hemolysis or beta thalassemia or thalassemia. The advantage of this fact is that it is not affected or less affected by inflammation. So you can use it to differentiate IDA from anemia of chronic disease. The disadvantage or drawbacks, I would say, again, not widely available, expensive, and there is a lack of standardization between laboratories. So I don't use it very frequently, very rarely we use it. Okay. And another sensitive marker, which we don't use much commonly, is free erythrocyte protoporphyrin or protoporphyrin to hemoglobin ratio. So this is a sensitive marker, early marker, but not specific. It can be elevated in not only in iron deficiency, but also in lead poisoning. Yeah, and of course,
elevated in lead poisoning.
Yeah. Yeah. So and a gold standard is bone marrow stainable iron, but we hardly do it. So the more practical is either your conventional iron parameters or response to therapy, as we discussed earlier.
Okay.
So I just want to add one thing here, that if you have done a bone marrow for some reason in an anemic child where you don't have a diagnosis, it will be not correct if you have not done iron staining.
Absolutely.
It's so simple a test, but sometimes you pick
that up. That should be routine.
In fact, the pathologist in a good hospital will never give you a bone marrow report without an iron stain.
Iron.
Yeah.
So having said all these parameters, Sandeep, do they help you in understanding evolution of iron deficiency with the help of these parameters?
Okay.
How does iron deficiency evolve?
The first is depletion of iron stores. So where your ferritin will go down and your bone marrow iron will be depleted, but you will not have any symptoms or your hemoglobin will look absolutely normal. So it leads to second stage, that is latent stage, where you have iron deficient erythropoiesis. Obviously there will be decreased ferritin, decreased transferrin saturation and iron. And on hemogram, you will have earliest indicator is increase in RDW and followed by obvious iron deficient anemia with decreased hemoglobin and microcytosis and hypochromia.
Thanks, Sandeep. We go on to the next case, case 4. Ashna? It's Parag, sorry. Parag, can you tell us about this child?
We had a 16-year-old boy. He presented to us with a complaining of short stature and delayed onset of puberty. On going through the old hospital records, we found that the child was having a long-standing anemia, and in last 6 to 7 years, he has received blood PCB transfusion 4 times. During this period, he has taken the multiple courses of iron therapy in adequate doses, but the anemia persisted. So while going through the records, we see a follow-up reports where there is no improvement in the hemoglobin level even after the child is supplemented with vitamin B12, folic acid and iron. So we further investigated to the cause of anemia in this child. We did a CBC. Hemoglobin was 7.8 gram per cent with the microcytic and hypochromic picture. RDW was high, 20%. Other blood parameters were normal. So this CBC confirms that there is a microcytic hypochromic anemia with a high RDW. So we investigated further. We checked the serum ion level, serum ferritin and the transferrin saturations were very low, while the total ion binding capacity was high, 400 microgram per DL. Stool for blood and the parasites were negative. Liver function test, renal function test, and the thyroid function test were normal. Urine was normal. Hemoglobin HB electrophoresis was also normal.
So now you have to comment on this case, sir. What would be your thoughts?
So I want to ask you whether this child is, what is the ancestry? Which part of the country he belongs to?
Arad.
Is he from Rajasthan, from North Indian states, or is he?
Sir, he was, I had seen this Marishan. Patient, sir. He hailed from North India. He was a Chowdhury.
So, I mean, it's a simple. This is iron deficiency, right? Iron deficiency beyond 5 years, iron deficiency needing transfusion, iron deficiency which does not respond to oral iron is not primary nutritional. This is not the age for nutritional iron deficiency. So is iron deficiency all right? Because you have proven it by doing a very low ferritin. This is secondary iron deficiency. You need to find out, is it some decreased absorption? Of course, you will look at the compliance and other things, but looking at a 14-year-old boy, I think all those points are futile. So you need to worry about bleeding or prevent or poor absorption. So I think the first thing I will do is a stool for occult blood, and I will check this child for celiac disease, because if he's from North Indian ancestry, then celiac is very common. And remember, they may not have chronic diarrhea. Although they come with failure to thrive, short stature, North Indian ancestry,
no pain,
some abdominal wake complaint and anemia. So they present in India more to hematologists than to the gastroenterologist.
Absolutely.
So I would straight away first do an anti-TTG, that if it's high, then it proves that it is celiac disease. Then you have two ways further. You want to prove it. The gastroenterologist always prefer to do a biopsy, show that there is bilious atrophy, then put on gluten-free diet, then see that the crypts have come back. If you can't do this because you are in a small area where pediatric gastroenterology is not available, then you put them on gluten-free diet and you see remarkable improvement in his height, appetite, growth, and in the hemoglobin. Then in hindsight, it proves that probably you are dealing with a celiac disease. And why is it important to know it is celiac is because you are going to give a label lifelong that he can't eat any wheat product, which is a major decision. So if you're in a borderline case, you should be very worried and be careful about labeling celiac disease. I've seen some children at 1 year and 1.5 years being labeled as celiac, and actually they're not celiac. And then you allow them to eat wheat later on, they're all okay. So be careful. This child, of course, is very typical.
And so, what I feel bad about this child, I mean, having diagnosed at 16 years when he was symptomatic since last 6-7 years. Yeah. So he's lost his very important period of growth. Mm-hmm. So we will need our endocrine friends to tell us whether, you know, he can reversible, whether this growth is reversible.
If he's a boy, it would probably, he can still catch up. If it was a girl, then it would have been much.
But whether he will reach his eventual genetic height is only.
May reach. Yeah. I mean, I have had children who have reached good height. Yes, Sandeep, you have.
Couple of comments. One, you said rightly it is more common in North India, but we do see many cases in Maharashtra as well.
I mean, we have yes.
But if all the ancestry, they will say their origin.
Secondly,
go ahead.
Yeah. Secondly, TTG IgA is a good screening test, but if it is negative, doesn't mean that patient doesn't have celiac. So if you are strongly suspecting, sometimes you can have IgA deficiency, that's why your TTG IgA is low, or sometimes you have associated CVID, that's why your TTG IgA is low, or in children less than 2 years of age, TTG IgA is not very sensitive or test. So in such cases, you should go ahead and do further tests, maybe a duodenal biopsy. And one of the tests which may help is HLA typing. So if you are celiac disease is associated with HLA DQ2 and DQ8. So that can help. It is not confirmatory, but that can help in proving the diagnosis.
So it goes without saying that when you ask for a TTG IgA, you should also ask for a total IgA, serum IgA, and then interpret. 9 out of 10 times, you will be able to diagnose. 1 out of 10 where you have difficulty in strongly suspecting, just refer them to a pediatric gastroenterologist, because they will do a much better job. Instead of trying to do all sorts of antibody, make patients spend a lot, and then he has nothing left to do a GI scopy, I think that will be futile.
So the biopsy is a gold standard.
That's
so these points have already been mentioned. So we go ahead with the next case.
And don't forget to refer them to for nutritional advice, because they need recipes which are gluten free. It's easy to say don't eat wheat, but he says what should I eat? So he wants recipe of breakfast, lunch, dinner, sometimes something extra, you know, and that craving for biscuit or ice cream, all that has to be very clearly defined by some nutritionist who knows how to give celiac diet.
And inadvertently, they may end up eating oats, rice, barley, yes, which also have gluten. So,
and I think,
so it's very important that they should be
One more point I want to make is that celiac disease is not uncommon as we think. And there are many adults who are diagnosed as celiac at the age of 30 and 40. They never had classical celiac, but they will be helped by a gluten-free diet. So I know of some of my pediatrician friends who have themselves been diagnosed or their spouses have been diagnosed celiac at the age of 40 and 50. So it's a disease which you should always keep in mind.
So Ashna, can you come on with the next case? Ashna, unmute yourself. Unmute. Ashna, unmute yourself.
We had a 10-year-old female child who was a known case of SLE. She was referred to the hematology unit for diagnosis and treatment of anemia. So her CBC was hemoglobin was 8.5 gram per cent, MCV was 73, MCH was 23, RDW was 16%, serum iron was low 23, TIBC was 230, ferritin was 150, and DCT was negative.
So Sandeep, can you help us interpret these indices and the iron studies in the view that this child is already a diagnosed case of chronic inflammatory disorder, SLE?
For SLE,
unmute your mic.
So she's a case of SLE. Yeah, she's a case of SLE with moderate anemia with microcytes and hypochromia. Obviously, in such cases, we know that they have functional iron deficiency because of increased hepcidin due to increased cytokines due to their inflammatory conditions. On top of that, they may have absolute iron deficiency. Now, it becomes very challenging to interpret iron studies or iron parameters in such situation because the iron parameters themselves are affected by chronic inflammation. For example, right, the serum iron will be low due to inflammation. The transferrin will be decreased in inflammation. And your ferritin being acute phase reactant, it will be increased. And your hepcidin will be increased. So here, there are some parameters which are not affected or less affected, I would say, like soluble transferrin receptor that we talked about earlier, and reticulocyte hemoglobin content, and erythropoietin. So these can help in distinguishing iron deficiency against the anemia of chronic disease. So out of this, I would say the best studied and with the most specificity and sensitivity is probably soluble transferrin receptor divided by log ferritin index. Okay. So this has been studied widely in last 4 or 5 years, and this has been found to be the best indicator to differentiate IDA from iron anemia of chronic disease. So if it is more than 1.5, it is suggestive of iron deficiency anemia, and if it is less than 1 in anemia of chronic disease. Of course, we have, as I said, there are problems of getting this test done easily, and there is problem in standardization. The another parameter which can be readily available on cell counter is reticulated hemoglobin content. If it is less than 28, it is suggestive of iron deficiency. Your RDW will be higher in cases of iron deficiency. And there is another marker, especially on Siemens cell counter, that is percentage of hypo. So if it is more than 6%, so which it measures RBCs with very low MCHC, that less than 17. So if the cell count of such this thing is more than 6%, so it is automatically given out by your cell counter. That is also suggestive of iron deficiency.
So basically, it goes that having these modern cell counters can be of real help in tough situations. So having diagnosed iron deficiency, sir, Dr. Nitisha, can you comment what is this pathophysiology of this anemia and chronic inflammation, and how to treat?
So we have been brought up as a medical student to talk about mucosal block theory. Now this is the mucosal block theory. Now we know that it works through the hepcidin and ferroportin pump. So very tightly the iron metabolism is covered by its release either at the basolateral membrane of the intestine or at the site of the bone marrow or in the site of the spleen, which is the RE system, or in the site of the liver. So at all these places, the iron is liberated from these storage spaces for utilization of erythropoiesis in the marrow. That is the primary source. And then to conserve the iron in the body for future use in case your diet is poor. If, and this is controlled by having hepcidin, which actually prevents the ferroportin pump from releasing iron from these sites. If hepcidin is low, it allows you a lot of iron to be absorbed and to be released. So you'll have iron overload syndrome in your body. If hepcidin is high, it will sequestrate this iron into the RE system and the liver and not make it available to the marrow. So there may be an actually total deficient iron in the body and also iron not available for erythropoiesis actively, or there may be an excess of iron in the RE system and yet there is not enough iron available to the bone marrow site because it's all sequestrated. So hepcidin blocks the ferroportin pathway. So hepcidin is the central molecule which is released from the liver, which is increased in inflammation, is also metabolically, genetically covered by pathways decrease or increase hepcidin level. So if you have decreased hepcidin level because of the molecules involved in the hepcidin synthesis, you get hemochromatosis. And if you have some molecular defect in not inhibiting hepcidin level, then hepcidin is unusually high unnecessarily. That is where, if we are discussing in future, what we call IREDA or iron refractory iron deficiency anemia. So hepcidin is the molecule, and in inflammation, hepcidin probably tries to sequestrate iron, but iron is oxidative to stress. So there's already an inflammation in the body in the form of SLE. Probably body tries to decrease the other oxidative stress by having a low free iron available, but in bargain you develop anemia. So that's the evolution of the humankind, probably I can explain. But the bottom line is you have to overcome this high hepcidin level if you have to treat the anemia. And the only way you can do it, not by oral iron, but it will all be slowly absorbed and taken away in the RE system and blocked there, is to overcome this block by giving them IV iron. So only way you can really treat this patient is by giving them IV iron therapy.
So according to you, what will be the indications of giving IV
ions? So IV iron indication in general are true intolerance in nutritional anemia.
Which is rare in children.
Rare, but sometimes you can have it in adolescent. Then malabsorption, which is not treatable, like celiac is treatable, but some malabsorption like short bowel, not treatable. You have to give IV iron. Any iron restrictive erythropoiesis, like chronic renal failure with or without erythropoietin, newborn preterm with erythropoietin, you need to give iron because iron is very rapid utilized. And lastly, where hepcidin is high, all inflammatory disorder, malignancy, SLE, RA, JA, etc., where you have to overcome this block by giving them IV iron. These are the four broad categories of giving IV iron.
So which are the iron salts that you've used in practice?
In the past, we used to use the iron dextran, which was good but could lead to anaphylaxis. But now we have very safe iron sucrose, or now we have even iron carboxymaltose. Iron sucrose, you can't give total dose. You have to fractionate it into 3 or 4 doses by giving them once in a week, not to exceed 4 mg per kg at one sitting. But you can give IV carboxymaltose compound as a total dose iron. So you calculate your total dose iron requirement by 4 into weight in kg into the deficit in hemoglobin. That's a rough calculation. Calculate into the elemental iron. You know what is the strength of your solution. Accordingly, you give that in 100 to 200 ml of normal saline. Give it over 1 or 2 hours. And that is the end of the entire iron therapy. If you are wanting to use IV sucrose iron, as I said, don't exceed 4 mg per kg at giving. So suppose you need 200 ml someone who is a 10 kilo child, you give 40 milligram 5 times. So every week for 5 weeks.
This is a very good alternative, I think, we've had, because initially, sir, these children would end up getting a lot of blood transfusions.
Absolutely.
So it is better that they go in for
So about FCM, as sir said, in most of the children we can give full dose, but again there is a limit. So you can give 15 mg per kg is the maximum. And if the, for example, in adolescent, if you want to give more, you will have to give it weekly, because if you give more dose, they end up sometimes having severe hypophosphatemia, and that can be a problematic. But in small children, we can safely give 15 mg per kg.
Most of the children
and
around,
more experienced with iron sucrose, for sure.
So iron carboxymaltose is recently approved for use in pediatric. By the way, it was not even allowed.
Yes.
So we have no other choice but to use IV sucrose. IV sucrose iron, you can give it an OPD basis. They don't have to admit them.
So then we can go on to next case. Parag, can we have the next case?
So Biba, I have to tell you that I have to leave in next 15 minutes.
So
after that, Sandeep will continue.
Quickly, sir, we'll be.
Yes, ma'am.
We had a 6-month-old a boy. He's a born of third degree consanguineous marriage. Referred to our hospital as a refractory anemia. The past years received a PCV transfusion 2 times, first at the age of 3 months and second at the age of 6 months. There is no family history of any blood-related disorders. Child is developmentally normal and exclusively breastfed. The mother's nutritional status is good. On anthropometric examination, the child's weight is less than 3rd centile, a height is between 3rd to 15th centile and head circumference normal. There was no dysmorphic features. The pallor was present and there is a hepatomegaly of almost 2 centimeters, no splenomegaly. On CBS examination, there was hemic murmur. So the CBC report, there is an anemia with a HbO of 6.1. There is a microcytic and hypochromic picture. RDW was 23.5. At rest, platelets and WBCs are normal. The iron studies, serum iron was high, 203 microgram per dl, total iron binding capacity normal, 333 microgram per dl, serum ferritin was very high, 1115 nanogram, HPLC report was normal with the fetal hemoglobin of 1.8%, stool for occult blood was negative, all of the hemolytic workup was negative, and the transferrin level was normal. So investigations were suggestive of microcytic anemia with a high RDW and increased iron status.
So Dr. Nitish, can you comment on this child?
Just go back to the history slide.
Sure, sir.
So he's a consanguineous marriage. Now remember, in hemato-oncology or in neurology, if you have a rare case where you're not able to come to diagnosis, there is consanguinity. By and large, it is a inherited metabolic disorder, whether it is of whatever cause. So that is one thing you should keep in mind. Number two, needing transfusion so early in life, it can never be iron deficient anemia because it doesn't present so early. So these are the two things. Third thing, he's got probably failure to thrive because his weight height were not up to the mark for his 6 months of age, right? So these three things tell us that he is a affected child, probably of some congenital disorder, which also has some liver palpable, though there is no spleen. And because, next slide, you have an seemingly iron deficient anemia child presenting very early in a consanguineous marriage, but having high ferritin, next slide, and high iron overload tells you that there are two or three metabolic disorders which can come iron deficiency like, but they are not iron deficiency.
So why not thal major, sir, if you don't have the workup over here?
If you have thal major, you should have had gross hepatosplenomegaly by now.
Right.
And before you do any further test, you will always do an electrophoresis. This is a child who will undergo electrophoresis. Number two, you will also see retic and a smear to see whether there is macrocytic anemia. Like you can have a diamond black one coming so early with transfusion dependent. I presume all that is ruled out. Then the next would be to, when you are high ferritin, it's two or things. One is either it's an iron refractory iron deficiency anemia or a sideroblastic anemia. So these are the two things. The fact that he's consanguineous marriage, it's probably autosomal recessive. You have to work off from these two. So the algorithm is to do a marrow and do iron stain. If that picks up sideroblastic, that's fine. If it doesn't pick up, then you do mutation analysis for IRIDA. That's how I would look at it.
Right. So Sandeep, you have any pointers towards...
And yeah. I have the TIBC, which is normal.
Yeah.
So it rules out A, transferrinemia or hypotransferrinemia. These are the three or four major metabolic disorder of iron which come like this.
Sandeep, any thoughts? Any of your thoughts?
So whenever, as sir rightly said, whenever you see... a child which looks like severe hypomicro with increased ferritin, so abnormal iron profile and requiring transfusion. So we have to think of some inherited causes. But before that, I would, any patient with iron refractoriness, I would first, as we have discussed earlier, first rule out the compliance, do the your celiac thing, do your iron TIBC ferritin and other indices. And after that, if your iron profile shows that your iron is low, your TI percentage saturation is very low, and your ferritin is low or low normal. Now, this is a typical pattern of IRIDA. Okay. So then you will do hepcidin level. If it is high, it is probably IRIDA. But if your iron serum iron is high and your ferritin is high, then you do the transferrin level, or you can deduce it by, as sir said, TIBC. If transferrin level is low, then probably you're dealing with hypotransferrinemia or atransferrinemia. And But if your transferrin level is normal, then you go ahead and do bone marrow. And if you see sideroblast, then it is probably sideroblastic anemia.
As you had said, this child turned out to be a sideroblastic anemia, proved on mutation analysis. So your thoughts on sideroblastic anemia?
Yeah, so it's very rare, but anyone who is iron deficiency not responding, you are lucky this is a small child, consanguineous marriage, it will tell you. But we have sometimes older children who just come with recurrent infection, they have some borderline hepatosplenomegaly, and they are behaving with iron deficiency, and they have received some transfusion once or twice in past. Is the time when you should think of. So, as Sandeep said, the algorithms are there to look into. You can alter the algorithm the way you want, but a marrow and an iron staining on the marrow is a must to rule out sideroblastic anemia. And all you need is most of them, 80% will respond to high dose pyridoxine. So it's such a treatable cause.
Yes. So basically, sideroblastic anemias are defects involving incorporation of iron into the heme molecule. And they can be either acquired or congenital. Congenital are X-linked, and acquired can be due to lead poisonings, aluminum poisoning, and so many other things. So
congenital can be also autosomal recessive, and not necessarily 30% can be autosomal recessive.
And in adults, you have clonal causes of sideroblastic anemia, for example, myelodysplasia. But thankfully, these are not so many common seen in children. So coming on to next case.
My last case.
So we have just two more cases left. So I think you can stay. So there are good 10 minutes.
Okay, fine. Go ahead.
So please, sir.
Okay.
So who is taking this case? Ashna, yes, please.
Yes, ma'am. 5-year-old boy born out of consanguineous marriage was referred for chronic anemia since age of 6 months. Had taken several hematinics over last 4 years. There was no history of any bleeding or non-transfusion. Except fatigue, he was asymptomatic.
Sandeep, mute your mic.
Ashna?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Outside investigations which were available were hemoglobin was between 6 and 8, which was hypochromic, microcytosis was present. Stool for occult blood was absent. Serum ferritin was between 20 to 30. HP electrophoresis was normal. Thyroid function test was normal. Celiac screening we had done was negative. And gluten-free diet trial, which failed. On examination, height and weight were between 3rd to 50th centile. Pallor was present. No platinachia, no angulate colitis was present. And no hepatosplenomegaly.
Investigations, Ashna?
Yeah, hemoglobin was 6.9 gram percent. MCV was microcytosis 51.9. RDW was 20.1. WBC and platelets were normal. Serum iron was low, which was 16.7. TIBC was raised 444. Ferritin was 29.94 and transferrin saturation was low, which was 3.76%.
So Sandeep, what is your comments now? You were pointing to something similar in the last case. This is your case.
So this case, as you can see, again, consanguinity is there. Very early onset of anemia and long-standing anemia. And patient has taken hematinics for 4 years, no response. And patient has been adequately investigated for any blood loss or HB electrophoresis or celiac, and which is all negative. So again, suggesting that it is some hereditary cause. Now, if you look at the iron studies pattern, so your serum iron is very low, and transferrin saturation is very low, so less than 5, and ferritin is low normal.
Okay. So this is the algorithm.
So you'll have to unmute yourself.
Sandeep, unmute.
Aloha. So this pattern is quite characteristic of IREDA. So as I said previously, this is a flow chart which suggests how you should deal with oral iron refractoriness. So if you have low iron, very low TSAT and normal ferritin, you do hepcidin level. If it is high, then it is likely IREDA, then you go ahead and do genetic test. Okay. If it is high iron, high ferritin, then consider hypotransferrinemia or sideroblastic anemia. If that is also not there, there are again very rare disorders like DMT1 deficiency or STIF3 deficiency. So those can also present in children with severe hypomicroanemia, which is refractory to iron therapy.
So finally, this child turned out to be a case of ERIDA, which is again an autosomal recessive disease. There is a loss of function mutation, also known as TMPRSS6 or MATRIX2, which is a negative regulator of hepcidin transcription. Sir had already mentioned about this. They present with severe microcytic hypochromic anemia. They have extremely low serum ions and transferrin saturations, and they're refractory to oral iron supplementation. More than 30 mutations have been described. And they may respond to oral iron with large doses of ascorbate, or even IV iron is work for them. We go on to our very last case. Yes, Sandeep.
Even to IV iron,
yes. So probably they'll require it lifelong. So basically, I have just summed up the genetic conditions of iron refractory, the truly iron refractory anemia. You can have defects of erythroid mitochondrial iron utilization like the sideroblastic anemias. You can have defect of iron absorption, iron refractory iron deficiency anemias, or you can have defect of iron transport and uptake.
Since the last case, we had a 9-year-old girl child. She came to us with a recurrent pain in abdomen. And
make
there
a slide, make a slide show, Viva.
Yes, sir, but I've lost the Zoom thing. I'm not seeing the...
Now we can
see. We can see it, ma'am.
Okay.
Go ahead, yeah.
But I'm not seeing the everybody's faces.
Doesn't matter, it's okay.
Nothing great to see
in our faces.
Okay, Parag.
This is the last case. We had a 9-year-old girl. She came to us with a recurrent pain in abdomen and generalized malaise and irritability since last 4 to 5 years. There is no history of any bleeding, no history of jaundice or pica. Except for the pallor, there are no other clinical findings. There is no hemolytic facies, no organomegaly. She has taken several courses of iron for the anemia after doing the CBCs. So this is a current CBC. There is anemia with a hemoglobin of 7.2 gram. MCV is 62, suggestive of microcytosis. Serum ferritin level was 69. Stool for open blood was negative. HB electrophoresis showed a hemoglobin A2 level of 5.3. The DCT was negative. Tissue transglutaminase IgE level was also negative.
This was a peripheral smear.
Yes.
Sir, Dr.
Nidhisha,
sir, your comments.
Yeah, so go back to the history. So she's a big girl who has got predominantly abdominal symptoms, malaise and irritability. So she's probably CNS plus GI involvement. Anemia is, by the way, she has been given iron again and again, which means she's found to be chronically anemic. Now, next slide. You are showing that she is microcytic hypochromic with ferritin, which is not very high. So she is probably iron deficiency like picture, but her A2 is high. So she also is a thalassemia minor. Now why would a thalassemia minor child remain so low and fall up to 7 gram? That's one. And second, why would she have this basophilic stippling? Thalassemia minor can have basophilic stippling, but when you have too much of basophilic stippling, along with the abdominal pain, irritability, I would like want to know the profession of the family. Are they goldsmiths or are they working in factory where the battery cells are made, or what is, or they are staying in very old house, like, you know, 100-year-old house where the flecky paints are coming out and there's some history of pica in a small child. All I'm trying to tell you that lead level is one thing which you should always do in a patient where there is iron deficient like picture, but someone not responding. So either in past, we used to have the FEP machine. I mean, when I was a student, we used to do a lot of FEP, but that's not available anywhere. Otherwise, you'll have spy high FEP. But in absence of that, now your lead levels, I would do a definite lead level. If lead levels are high, then I would think that probably she's having some lead poisoning.
So you correctly pointed out. So we did a lead level in this child, and which was extremely high.
Okay. So remember, there is no lead in the lead pencil. The pencils are graphite. There's no lead in the petrol. It is deleaded petrol. There's no lead in the paints. The paints are deleaded. So all the lead that you have now is old houses where leaded color paints were there and the flakes come out, or lead which is there in sindoor, or the lead that is there in Ayurvedic medicine, or the lead is used as a lead vapor to distill gold from the gold dust. So we have a family of goldsmiths where I practice. They in past used to have a very dingy small room, and they would try to take out dust from the dust gold. They buy this gold dust in bulk from the factory and distill gold from that. And they would use lead vapor. And because they don't have proper exhaust, they all used to have lead poisoning. Families of them. And then we taught them simple thing that they need to take the furnace, which is used today in the kitchens where they have a big furnace. We take the vapor out and straight throws it out at a height of the house. And the lead level started falling and the lead poisoning disappeared. So you can still get lead from bullets. You can get lead from paints. You can
toys.
Chinese toys, not Indian toys. Chinese toys. All that can be the source of lead today. But generally, lead poisoning, which used to be in past, has fallen greatly because the petrol is deleted, the pencils are not lead, and the paint is no more lead.
And this one point.
This share is in urgent need of treatment because
it's more than 6. It's very high levels. I think the American Academy says that anything more than 5 is high, and children start becoming symptomatic more than 10.
I will tell you one story of a family where the woman came and she said that my child, I suspect someone is poisoning him. And she used to do this poison profile. And in that, the lead is the first thing that they do. And the lead were always higher than the normal range. They were between 15 and 20. And she kept on doing those tests. And one fine day, she says, no, there's something wrong. And then she was suspecting the mother-in-law that she's poisoning the grandchild for some reason. But we found out, actually, I contacted the local municipality and they did the study and they found out that the water was having lead there because it was being contaminated by a factory which was using lead in that area. So see how suspicion can turn into a public health issue.
There was an extremely good English movie also on that. So I forget the name.
Oh, I see.
But they talked about the poisoning. This pretty woman heroine, I think she worked in that. A very, very nice movie. Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, Sandeep?
I just want, can you go back to the smear?
Yes.
So just wanted to point out, so this basophilic stippling, as sir said, it can be seen in beta thalassemia minor as well. But the difference is, in beta thalassemia minor, it is fine stippling. So if you look very carefully, the stippling in lead poisoning is coarse. The basophilic stippling is coarse because lead inhibits pyrimidine 5 nucleotidase enzyme, and because of that you have ribosomal RNA which is present in these RBCs. So similar picture you can see in congenital deficiency of pyrimidine 5 nucleotidase deficiency as well.
That will come as hemolytic anemia.
Yeah.
All right, time for me to go.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thanks for being there with us. And sir, we are leaving you on time.
Sorry, I'm very extremely sorry.
We are leaving you on time, sir. You wanted to leave.
Bye, Sandeep. Bye, everybody. Bye,
sir.
My promise. Thank you so much, sir. Thanks for us. Thanks for being with us. No. So we are concluding the sessions over here. I would just like to summarize some learning objectives for our students. Iron deficiency anemia is a commonest. So please check for your iron formulation, the dose, compliance. You have to spend some more time on explaining to the parents, but it's worth it. Look at the nutritional history of the child. Look at excessive milk intake, bottle feeding, fresh cow's milk. If you don't find your answer there, look for the covered blood losses, especially your worms, all sorts of worms. And then don't forget the menstruation, rarely the lungs. Look out for any chronic infections, inflammatory disorders, rule out celiac disease. And then look at the other causes of hypochromic microcytic anemia like thalassemia minor or lead poisoning. And finally, last, very, very rarely, if you've worked up your cases well, look for causes like sideroblastic anemia and IBDR. Thank you very much, everybody, for being there with us. And that's the end of our session. Thank you.
Thank you everyone for joining. Request you to kindly fill the feedback form. The link is in the chat box. Thank you everyone.
Thank you.